हेलो एवरीवन, माय नेम इज़ कृति सवानी एंड आई एम अ थर्ड ईयर मेडिकल स्टूडेंट फ्रॉम श्रीमती काशीबाई नवले मेडिकल कॉलेज एंड जनरल हॉस्पिटल पुणे। सो आवर टॉपिक फॉर टुडेज डिस्कशन इज़ सेरेबेलम। आई नो सेरेबेलम इज़ द ऑफन मोस्ट नेग्लेक्टेड पार्ट ऑफ आवर सिलेबस, वेदर इट बी फ्रॉम एनाटॉमी और फिजियोलॉजी पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू, बट अकॉर्डिंग टू मी इट इज़ रियली इम्पॉर्टेंट फ्रॉम क्लिनिकल न्यूरोलॉजी पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू, बिकॉज अंडरस्टैंडिंग सेरेबेलम विल हेल्प अस टू डिफरेंशिएट अदर लीजन्स फ्रॉम द सेरेब्रल कॉर्टेक्स एंड अदर एबनॉर्मिलिटीज़। सो इट इज़ रियली इम्पॉर्टेंट टू नो फिजियोलॉजी एंड एनाटॉमी अबाउट सेरेबेलम। सो आर डिस्कशन फॉर सेरेबेलम टूडे विल बी इन बिट्स एंड इन पार्ट्स। सो स्टार्टिंग विद द डेवलपमेंट, सो सेरेबेलम डेवलप्स फ्रॉम द मेटेंसेफेलॉन, विच इज़ द एम्ब्रियोनिक पार्ट, एंड द अडल्ट पार्ट विल कॉरस्पॉन्ड टू द हाइंड ब्रेन। सो मेटेंसेफेलॉन गिव्स राइज टू टू स्ट्रक्चर, वन इज सेरेबेलम एंड वन इज पॉन्स। ओके, एंड द लोकेशन ऑफ द सेरेबेलम इज़ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टू नो। सेरेबेलम इज लोकेटेड पोस्टीरियर टू पॉन्स एंड मेड्यूला एंड ऑल्सो टू द फोर्थ वेंट्रिकल। सो दिस इज द सेरेबेलम। ओके, एंड द थर्ड पॉइंट इज रिलेशन, दैट्स व्हाट आई टोल्ड यू। सो रिलेशन इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट व्हेन वी लर्न अबाउट द फोर्थ वेंट्रिकुलर ट्यूमर्स, दैट इज मेड्यूलोब्लास्टोमा। एट दैट टाइम दिस लोकेशन एंड रिलेशन विल बी रियली हेल्पफुल टू अंडरस्टैंड दिस पैथोलॉजी। ओके, सो या एंड नाउ विल स्टार्ट विद द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ सेरेबेलम। सो सेरेबेलम हैज डिस्टिंक्ट पार्ट्स। द सेंट्रल मोस्ट पार्ट यू आर सीन इज कॉल्ड एज वर्मिस। ओके, एंड देन दीज टू आर द हेमिस्फियर, दिस विल बी द राइट हेमिस्फियर एंड दिस विल बी द लेफ्ट हेमिस्फियर। द हेमिस्फियर अगेन इज डिवाइडेड इंटू टू पार्ट, द लैटरल मोस्ट पार्ट इज कॉल्ड एज लैटरल हेमिस्फियर एंड द पार्ट बिटवीन द वर्मिस एंड लैटरल हेमिस्फियर इज कॉल्ड एज द इंटरमीडिएट हेमिस्फियर। ओके, सो देर आर डिफरेंट फंक्शंस एट्रीब्यूटेड टू डिफरेंट पार्ट्स ऑफ सेरेबेलम। ओके, सो द वर्मिस विल कंट्रोल एक्सियल स्केलेटन एंड प्रॉक्सिमल लिम्ब मूवमेंट्स, द इंटरमीडिएट हेमिस्फियर विल कंट्रोल डिस्टल लिम्ब मूवमेंट्स, एंड द लैटरल हेमिस्फेयर विल कंट्रोल कोऑर्डिनेशन एंड मोटर प्लानिंग। सो वॉट डज दिस मीन, मोटर प्लानिंग? सो वेन एवर वी आस्क आर ब्रेन टू परफॉर्म एनी वॉलेंट्री मोमेंट, सो आर ब्रेन विल सेंस दिस दिस इम्पल्स एंड सेंड इट वाया द स्पाइनल कॉर्ड टू डिस्टिंक्ट मसल्स। बट टू परफॉर्म दिस मोटर प्लानिंग विथ फाइन एक्यूरेसी, यू नीड टू have a controller which will help in fine tuning of the voluntary movements. So yeah, then the cerebellum comes into play, so it will help you in motor planning and it will also help you to learn procedural movements. Let's take an example. If you're driving a two-wheeler, so on the first day you will be unaware how to drive it, and then later with each frequent session your body will give an update to cerebellum so as to learn it as a procedural movement. So with each session you will get better and better, so that will help with the cerebellum. Okay, and then one important structure here is floconodular lobe. This will help us with balance and eye movements. Okay, and then there is other structure called as peduncles. So there are three peduncles: superior, middle and inferior peduncles. So significance of this will come in the later part of our discussion. So let's start. And you must be wondering how to remember whether which part of cerebellum will control which movement, whether it be proximal or distal or balance or whatever. So I have projected a picture here which will help you learn that. So see, vermis is the central part, this is the intermediate part, and then this is the lateral hemisphere part. Okay, so what did we discuss? If this vermis is going to control axial movement and proximal limb movement, so that will be corresponding to here. This is the homunculus topographically demonstrated here. So this is the trunk or axial skeleton, and these are the proximal limbs and muscle. So that will be controlled by the hemisphere. And then what we discussed was the intermediate hemisphere will control distal limb movement. So these are the distal limbs of the homunculus, and that will be controlled by the intermediate hemisphere. So this will really help you understand this. Okay, so talking about the inputs and everything, so all the inputs to the cerebellum is excitatory. Okay, and that is by the glutamate neurons of the Purkinje cells. ओके एंड द इनपुट एंटर्स थ्रू द मिडल सेरेब्रल पेडंकस एंड इन्फीरियर सेरेब्रल पेडंकस द वन विच वी डिस्कस्ड हियर सो इट वॉज मिडल इन्फीरियर एंड सुपीरियर पेडंकस ओके एंड सो वॉट डज दिस इम्प्लाई ऑल इनपुट्स टू सेरेबेलम इज शुड बी एक्साइटेटरी मीनिंग देयर बाय वेन आई टोल्ड यू कि सेरेबेलम will come into play when you need fine tuning of your voluntary muscles. So let's say that a brain got impulse to move our left hand and to pick up a pencil from there. Okay, so that was the impulse given to the brain and brain will go and haphazardly, you know, move your left hand, but the fine tuning will be provided by the cerebellum. So here the input comes into role, that is the cerebellum will get the excitatory input, which is haphazardly going there. So cerebellum will detect the errors in the movement. So this input, that's why it is excitatory. And the output from the cerebellum will be inhibited by the GABA neurons. So what does this imply? Excitatory input that was haphazard movement of your left hand, that was the input. And now the cerebellum asking the left hand to, you know, slow it down and then take a pencil at a particular point and not the rubber which is beside the pencil. Okay, so that will help you with that. And all the output from cerebellum is inhibited by the GABA neurons. Output is through the superior cerebral peduncles. So now can you distinguish? Inputs are through middle and inferior cerebral peduncles and output is through superior cerebellar peduncles. Okay, so here they modulate output of the deep cerebellar nuclei. So this will come in the forthcoming discussion where we'll discuss more about deep cerebellar nucleus. Okay, so yeah, this was the organization of the cerebellum. Now let's learn about the tracks. Okay, how the cerebellum will help us with the fine tuning. Okay, so starting with the cerebellum here, I told you cerebellum output will be through the deep cerebellar nucleus. Deep cerebellar nuclei. So the cerebellum here will give their output through the deep cerebellar nuclei. Now let's learn about cerebellar nuclei. So from medial to lateral, there are three main important cerebellar nuclei. The medial most is the fastigial nucleus, and the middle one is the interposed nucleus, and the lateral most and the largest of the all cerebellar nuclei is the dentate nucleus. Okay, so this interposed nucleus is again divided into two, that is emboliform and globose nucleus. Okay, so output from the cerebellum will go through these deep cerebellar nuclei and then it will synapse in the dentate nuclei, and the axons from here will go out to the superior cerebellar peduncle. Now can you correlate? I've told you output is through superior cerebellar peduncles. Okay, and then axons after synapsing in superior cerebellar peduncles will go to thalamus, and that after crossing the midline. Okay, so this axons will cross the midline and it will go to thalamus. Thalamus may it will synapse, relayer, and then it will go and modify upper motor neuron output. Okay, so it started with the cerebellum, goes to the cerebellar nuclei. From there, it will project into the superior cerebellar peduncle. It will cross the midline. It will go to thalamus. It will modify the upper motor neurons. And then it will traverse through the corticospinal tract. Okay, so as you all know, corticospinal tract will cross midline again at the pyramidal decussation. So can you appreciate one thing here? That the neurons coming from the, let's say the left side of cerebellum will cross here at this place, and after as a corticospinal tract again it will cross the midline at the pyramidal decussation. Okay, so can you make out that the fibers have crossed twice, so it is known as double decussation. So this will tell us that if the left part of cerebellum is damaged, the manifestation will be on the left side itself, that is ipsilateral manifestation. Okay, and this will come to play again when I'll discuss more about it. Okay, so now let's talk in detail whether which part of neuron projects in which part of cerebral hemispheres. Okay, so as I told you, excitatory input from the climb excitatory inputs to the cerebellum will be from the climbing fibers. Okay, and it is through the Purkinje cell, and then after the output it will project into the deep cerebellar nuclei. Okay, and I told you that output is inhibitory and input is excitatory. Okay, so that's what we said here, ki there are four deep cerebellar nuclei. Actually it is three, then the second one is divided into two. I told you emboliform and globus. Okay, so each cerebellar nuclei is corresponding to each part of cerebellar hemispheres. So let's see that. So first let's talk about floconodular lobe. Let me remind you, floconodular lobe, this is the green part. I told you it helps with balance and eye movement. So let's see how does it actually helps with balance and eye movement. So yeah, so the inhibitory output via the deep cerebellar nuclei, it will be coming from floconodular lobe and vermis, and then it will be going to this fastigial nucleus, which I told you is a deep cerebellar nuclei. Okay, and then it will be projecting into the lateral vestibular nucleus. So this vestibule, you know from your ENT subject that it is it is an important structure for your balance. So it will project into lateral vestibular nucleus, and then it will help you in positional change in eye movements in response to your head movement. That is, with the change of your head movement, it will help to change of your eye movements. Okay, and then this fastigial nucleus will also send or also control axial skeleton and proximal musculature, as I told you, which is a part of vermis. So as discussed earlier, vermis will control axial skeleton and proximal limb movements. Okay, so here it actually corresponds to your axial skeleton and proximal musculature. Okay, and the intermediate hemisphere will project their neurons into interposed nucleus. I told you it is of two types, emboliform and globus. Okay, and as discussed earlier, intermediate hemisphere will correspond to distal limb movements. Okay, so it will control distal limb movements via the reticulospinal tract and rubrospinal tract. Now let's see here what is actually it. So this is the intermediate part of your cerebellar hemisphere. It will project into the one of the interposed nucleus as discussed earlier, and then it will go to red nucleus, which is a part of midbrain, and that is how it will go and come along with the rubrospinal tract. Okay, so this is how this intermediate hemisphere will be corresponding with the rubrospinal and reticulospinal tracts. Okay, and the last part is the lateral hemisphere. So lateral hemisphere will be projecting into the lateral most cerebellar nucleus, that is dentate nucleus, and it is by far the largest nucleus of the cerebellum. Okay, so this dentate nucleus will project into thalamus, which is venterolateral and anterior part of the thalamus, which will influence the upper motor neurons in the cerebellar cortex, and then upper motor neurons are influenced, hence the lower motor neurons will also be influenced via the corticospinal tract. This is the thing which I told you, lateral part, which will go to dentate nucleus, then the axons will leave through superior cerebellar peduncles, it will cross the midline, then will go to thalamus, and then the thalamus will be projecting to the upper motor neurons, hence will influence their output, and then the upper motor neuron through the corticospinal tract will influence the lower motor neurons. So now you must be able to appreciate what I was telling before via this. So yeah, that was a normal physiology and anatomy of the cerebellum.